we are so dead. Every time I see a solar panel going onto a rooftop, or when I read about a wind farm going online, the first thought that crosses my head is, we as human race are so dead. Before I get judged as a climate change denier, let me reaffirm my position. As an electrical engineer, I'm absolutely petrified and slightly inspired by the grave challenges and enormous threat that climate change poses to human race. It is this respect for climate change that convinced me and my friends to quit our cushy jobs and instead focus on solving the greatest challenge of our generation, climate change. As children, we were all promised a much greener, much cleaner future. But ever since the era when we saw solar panels only on satellites and calculators to today, where solar panels are everywhere, the grid continues to be black. It hasn't really gone green. Why is that so? We have all heard of the cliche, sun does not always shine and wind does not always blow. This inherent, intermittent and unpredictable nature of renewables have brought about a lot of problems and challenges onto the power grid. The power grid that we know of today has been relatively unchanged in the last 120 years or so and has been designed for stable operations of baseload generators that burn fossil fuels. In the last couple of decades, grid operators across the world have perfected the art of matching demand and supply curves. However, with the proliferation of renewables on the grid, this status quo has now been challenged. A typical demand curve peaks around late mornings and evenings. However, solar generation typically peaks around midday. So the apparent demand to a traditional baseload generator reduces as the day progresses towards the noon and rapidly increases during the evenings. This sudden ramping up and down of the baseload generator creates a lot of pressure on both the grid operators as well as the baseload generators. This therefore creates a very ironic situation on the power ecosystem, wherein the more number of renewables you have on the grid, the more dependency you have on baseload generators that use fossil fuels. This phenomena is called the duck curve. On the other hand, there are periods during which renewable power plants generate power in excess of the grid side demand. In such situations, grid operators kick off such power plants, therefore impacting their revenue generating potential as well as profitability. This phenomenon is called curtailment, and it affects not just renewable power plants but also the entire grid. The solution, however, is insanely simple. It's a no-brainer. Batteries. If you could only store energy from the renewable power plants during their peak generation and utilize this stored energy during peak demand, we would not really require baseload generators. Green power plants along with batteries could effectively act as baseload power generators, and finally we could have a grid that is actually green. But we have all seen Elon Musk with his gigantic grid scale batteries. Why can't we use them and convert our black grid into green grid? I would rather quote a very famous Bill Gates quote here. All the batteries in the world can only store 10 minutes of the world's energy needs. This goes to show how incapable lithium ion and other electrochemical batteries are at solving this problem. While electrochemical batteries are excellent at storing energy for short duration, and they can ramp up power generation from zero to full within milliseconds, they are extremely bad both technologically as well as financially at storing long duration energy at grid scales. Future of human race doesn't have to be so grim. Some of the smartest minds on the planet are busy working out a solution to this gigantic problem. In fact, there are a handful of solutions already on the horizon which do show the promise of solving this problem. One such solution is pumped hydro, and it has been in existence for quite a while now. In this solution, off-peak electricity from the grid is taken in and water is pumped to a height. During discharge phase, this water goes through a turbine and generates electricity. The only problem in this solution is that the energy density is quite low. If you had to store energy for the Californian power grid, the height of dam would extend to the moon. That is obviously impractical. Then there are other solutions as well. Solutions such as compressed air energy storage, wherein off-peak electricity from the power grid is utilized to compress air to a high pressure in underground caverns or pressurized tanks. During discharge phase, this compressed air is run through a turbine to generate electricity. The problem in this solution is thermodynamics. As you compress air, the air tends to heat up. Heated air is much more difficult to compress and therefore reducing the efficiency of such storage. Other storage is thermal energy storage. In this storage, various methods such as molten salts or phase change materials or sensible heat are used. The problem, however, is either they have very low energy density, such as sensible heat, or they're very expensive and have lower energy density, like phase change materials, and therefore are not useful for long duration grid scale energy storage. Then there are molten salts, which can be utilized for grid scale energy storage for long, relatively long duration, but they go to very high temperatures above 600 degrees Celsius, wherein such molten salts become extremely corrosive and hence very expensive to handle. There is also a problem of agglomeration, which defeats the entire purpose of molten salt energy storage. Then there are advanced new proposals such as gravity-city, in which heavy mass of concrete are lifted on cranes to a height, and this potential energy is utilized by letting the concrete fall and thereby turning a generator. This generator then generates electricity for the power grid. During a recharge period, grid from the off-peak electricity from the grid is utilized to run the generator as a motor and pull the concrete back up. However, there are materials challenges and fatigue loss and scalability issues with such proposals. And then there's my all-time favorite, chemical energy storage. In this type of energy storage, energy is stored within the bonds of chemical compounds. During recharge phase, off-peak electricity is utilized to break bonds of a chemical and separate it into its chemical constituents. During discharge phase, these constituent chemicals are made to react with each other in a highly exothermic reaction, thereby giving off a lot of thermal energy. This thermal energy then drives a steam turbine generator, which then generates electricity. The benefits of such kind of energy storage solution are immense. The processes, chemicals, equipments used in these kind of technologies are often time-tested and proven in the industry. They are highly scalable, often linearly scalable to gigawatt-hour levels. They can store energy without any significant losses for months together, and they are extremely inexpensive due to the inexpensive components and chemicals utilized. They tend to be 2 to 4 times cheaper than the best lithium ion in the market. And several prototypes have been demonstrated in the real world up to a couple of megawatt levels. And while I would bet all my money on chemical energy storage solution, one must understand that the challenge we face is huge. And it's not something that could be solved or can be solved by one single person or company or institution or technology. This has to be a collaborative approach, and the solution has to be a collaborative, cumulative solution. This is in fact going to bring humanity together, solving some of the biggest problems of our generation. And in the end, I would only say I really hope from the bottom of my heart that the entire human race puts their differences away and come together to solve this gigantic problem that challenges our generation. Only then can we solve this, otherwise the future is indeed grim, however sad that might seem. Thank you so much.